Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, it's a great pleasure today to have Professor Stephen Boyd from Stanford. He's a Samsung professor in engineering and a professor in the electrical engineering department. His work on convex decomposition and applications are very well known. I need no introduction. He's written several books, the most, you know, very popular, the convex decomposition with Levin Vandenberg. I think that's very, very popular now. And also, his group has produced several very popular software, including CVX. Okay, today he's gonna talk about distributed decomposition, where ADMM. Okay.
Yeah. Good. Thanks. So, we have a small audience, so you can actually. I mean, we should make it super interactive. So, actually, you might be disappointed if you know a lot about, you know, the most recent things in optimization. You'll probably be disappointed. Just a heads up. But anyway, feel free to stop me anytime, and otherwise I'll just keep going. And yeah, so we'll make it very interactive. So this is what I'm going to talk about today is actually based on a longer paper. It's kind of like a survey paper that you can find on the web, and you can find all source code for everything and all that kind. You know, it's sort of pedagogical codes, things like that. There. But stop me at any moment. Also, to speed me up, if you're like, yeah, please, we know all this, then that's even worse. So, okay. So, quickly, the goals. So the goal is you wanted to be able to do arbitrary scale optimization. And so you want to do things like, you know, machine learning with big data sets. You might want to do dynamic optimization on a large scale network. So suppose you're doing power scheduling or energy scheduling across a network, you have we'll see examples like this later, but you know, you have a whole bunch of generators and consumers of electricity or something like that. They're all connected by some network with, you know, tens of thousands of lines. These are all capacitated and have losses and stuff like that. And before you know, and you're scheduling out over time, so in 15-minute increments over a day. And the next thing you know, you actually have a very large problem, right? So we'll look at ones like that later. Okay, so computer vision is another, you know, no-brainer. So you have like HD video coming at you, and you're solving some convex optimization problem involving that. These are big problems. Okay. Okay. And the key, of course, is decentralized optimization, right? Because I mean, a lot of these things they wouldn't even fit in the memory of a single machine. So you know, we'll do something decentralized. And the idea is you have we'll call them. And everything. I'll interchangeably talk about devices, processes, agents. But in fact, these can be anything. You can also have this at a lower level. These can be threads, for example. And in fact, we've done a bunch of implementations where we do all this, and there's a thread pool, and that kind of stuff. But it could also be things at much higher level too. They could actually be separate physical devices. And so the idea is you have a bunch of little optimization problems that are solved. I mean, little could be anything from something that's trivially solved analytically to something where there's some serious heavy lifting done. And then relatively small messages are passed, and the hope is that eventually you arrive at the solution of the big problem. By the way, without having collected all the data in one place, right? So this is the idea. I mean, and this is just to get everybody on the same page. Okay, so the outline is this. We're gonna go back in history. I'll take 10, 15 minutes to actually literally trace history. So I'll talk about dual decomposition, right? So that's actually from the early 60s. Probably you could argue it's earlier than that. These are things Danzig wrote about in his first book on linear programming. We'll then get to the 70s, which would be method of multipliers. Then from there, we'll move to alternating direction method of multipliers, which is what I'm going to talk about today. That's actually from the 70s, and it's easily argued that the ideas are from the 50s. Okay, so you came to a talk about a method from the 50s. I mean, yeah, there's a little bit more to say about it, but actually not much. So we'll see. Then what we're going to do, and actually the theme of the talk is that, you know, this is obviously not a new method, right? So this is not some new method that, you know, we hatched up last year or something like that. But actually, I think what's more interesting about it is that it's so simple, and then you're so effective when you know these methods that you can piece together solutions, solving methods, algorithms to solve problems, that are on distributed platforms, all sorts of things. And you can just kind of put these together like, you know, Lego bricks or something. What you'll end up with will not be the best one for that problem class, right? So, there's no exception where, you know, once you have a specific problem, you say, oh, I really, really want to solve that problem. There's going to be a better one than, but the idea is for rapid prototyping, I find this is actually quite appealing, right? It's just, you just stick the things together and it just works. And so that's this part. We'll talk about just some common patterns. Everything I'll say there will be, the algorithm I'll talk about here, it's completely trivial. It's two lines, three lines, it's very, very short. It's not intuitive, but it is actually. We'll look at that. And then you know a couple of tricks here. Everything I'll say there will be completely trivial, right? And then it turns out this algorithm, you take a few trivial things, you combine them, and all of a sudden you're quite effective. And that we'll look at some examples. Then we'll come back at the end to talk about distributed big problems. And we'll talk about consensus, and actually it's dual, which is an exchange problem. Okay? So these are, and then I'll wrap up. So, okay. So let's start with dual decomposition. The year is, I don't know, 1949 or something like that. But here's the idea. You want to solve this equality constrained optimization problem. You want to minimize F subject to AX equals B. And so you form a Lagrangian. And, you know, you could make up a story about this, and you could say, you know, this might be that a market, this is the constraint that a market clears, that supply equals demand or something like that. And then you'd interpret this dual variable here as a set of prices. And this says go ahead and violate. Don't let the, you know, use more or less than you're allowed to or something like that. But you'll be paid for it, or you'll pay for it. I mean, so it depends, of course, on the sign of yi and the residual, the ith component of the residual, right? And so you think of y as dual variables, prices, something like that. Okay. Now the dual function says make the best choice of x for the given set of prices. And then that's a function of the prices. And this thing is actually always a concave function. So it curves down. Okay. And then the dual problem is you choose the prices that makes this dual function as large as possible. So it's actually the least favorable set of prices. And it turns out the least favorable set, you know, and then if all goes well, and there's a bunch of sort of assumptions here, these are not just little silly borderline assumptions, these are real ones, right? If all goes well, then you can recover the optimal thing by finding an optimal price and then minimizing this thing. And it's kind of interesting because there's a lot of big market interpretation of this. So the key is, so you'd say here, if you like, this is solving this the first problem by price discovery. That's what it's doing, right? So if you actually solve this problem, you're doing price discovery. And this says once you've found the right price, everybody sort of, you just minimize over x, and you're going to get the solution, right? So, okay. Okay. So how might you do price discovery, which just means maximize the dual function? Well, gradient. So let's just do a gradient or subgradient method if it's non-differentiable. So that works like this. You find the gradient of this thing, and then you're going to step. We want to maximize, so we step in the positive direction of the gradient. You make a step of length alpha. It's not length alpha, but step size alpha. And the gradient of this thing turns out to be exactly the residual when you actually compute the minimizer of the Lagrangian. So you get dual ascent is this method here. And actually, the reason you should look at it is because this things that will look like this, you're going to be staring at for 1 hour. They all look the same. And they always have a step that goes like this. You lock down a set of prices, and you minimize over x. Okay, that's the first step. And the next step is you calculate the residual. That's this thing. You want AX equals B. This is the residual. Or, you know, it's the amount by which the market fails to clear, or, you know, whatever your application is, okay? That's a residual. If the residual is zero, stop, because you're optimal, right? If it's not zero, then it says make update the prices. So that's a dual update, price update. So everything you're going to see is going to look like this from now on, okay? So there's going to be just variations on this theme.
Yes, okay. So in some practical problem, here you do gradient descent anyway. Right? You might as well do the gradient on the original problem.
Absolutely. So we haven't gotten to the question, why would you do this? Right? And in fact, it's pretty complicated, right? We could have done gradient descent on minimize f of x, and I agree completely. I'm going to answer it on the next slide. Okay? So, oh, I should say, this method works, but with a lot of strong assumptions. And they're not just like silly little mathematical things, you know, that don't come up in practice. They're quite real. So, for example, you might want to solve a linear program. This method will fail utterly and completely. It just won't work at all. Okay? So it's not, these are real conditions, right? They're not like little, you know, analytical things that don't really happen in practice. Okay? So, but it, you know, works. Okay? I mean, if these assumptions hold. Okay, now I'm going to answer your question about why would you make it complicated and, you know, run gradient on the dual or something. I mean, of course, there is one reason you might do it. It's because it sounds more sophisticated. So you can so you could impress your friends and stuff and say, I'm running gradient descent on the dual, right? And it sounds okay. So there is that. I mean, that's a real advantage. I think a lot of papers get written for reasons like that. Okay, so okay, but here's a real reason. Here's a real reason. This is the entry point to distributed optimization. So now I'm going to show that this is it. This is the point. So it says, suppose that function f is separable, meaning x gets chunked up into x1 up to xn. These are blocks of variables, right? And f is a sum. By the way, of course, if I minimize f of x, it's trivially parallelizable because I just minimize each one separately. Right? It's a sum. So ax equals b, that's the equality, that's linking them. So except for the equality constraints, the problem would be trivially parallelizable, right? So this is the idea. Well, if you form the Lagrangian, it's f of x, you know, plus, you know, y transpose ax minus b. Y transpose ax minus b is an affine function. It's completely separable. So what it says is the Lagrangian splits into a private Lagrangian part for each of these x's. And that says that when you're asked to minimize L over X, it is actually, you're minimizing a separable sum where these things have nothing to do with each other, and it's trivially parallelizable. So that is the reason you do the dual, because if I have a big problem where all variables are coupled, if I then do the dual and if I fix the price, that problem becomes separable, and that's very cool. So, I mean, that's kind of the idea of a lot of markets and stuff like that. Once I set the price, everybody in this room decides how much they're going to consume or contribute to the market, right? Independently. Yeah, so that's the answer. Okay, so this leads us to dual decomposition. The year is about 1960. Okay, so here it is. Actually, it's nothing here. We've just assumed it's separable, and the only thing that's happened is that this thing, which is a parallel, this is all done in parallel. This thing here is minimizing it. It's the x minimization step. So the algorithm hasn't changed at all. We've just simply noted that this step, when you do x minimization, is in parallel. Okay? So, and then we collect everybody's contributions. We add them up, subtract b. That's our residual. If it's zero, we quit. Otherwise, we update the price. And you can see, roughly speaking, it's something. Well, the simple, if you want, the simple explanation is it's that you have a scatter gather for each step. You scatter the price, right? Everybody does whatever they're going to do. That's this thing here. And then you gather their contributions. That's these things, right? And then this. Actually, it's not a scatter gather. It's actually an all reduce. But you had a question.
I forgot to ask a question earlier.
Yeah, sure.
How careful do you have to be in choosing the alphas?
We'll get to that.
Okay.
Yeah. So the short answer is for these algorithms, actually, these are quite slow and finicky. And depends on whether you want to do theory or practice. If you want to do theory, alpha k equals 1 over k just always works, period.
Okay,
period.
That's super slow.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, that's super slow, exactly. So we'll come back to your question several times.
Yep.
And I'll give completely different answers, like it's an easy one like 1 over k so we'll get back to that. Okay. So this works. And it's kind of cool. And if someone says, you know, what's happening here, you'd say, well, you know, everyone here is minimizing their own function. And what's happening is I then take I collect everybody's ideas, xi. I see if we've cleared the market or whatever this means. If yes, we tell everybody to stop. Otherwise, we update the price vector and we broadcast that out. And everyone says, okay, guess what? The prices of all the commodities have changed. Now what would you do? Right, so it's very intuitive, the algorithm. Okay, all right. By the way, that works, but with lots of assumptions, right? So, and real assumptions that would keep you from solving problems you really want to solve. Okay, method of multipliers. So now we're going up to 1973 or something, 70s, 80s? Okay. So what we'll do is we'll look at the augmented Lagrangian. So you take the function plus this is the usual Lagrangian, right? And this has sort of the, you know, the economic interpretation or something, which is, you know, violate the constraint but pay for it. Or you get a subsidy, right? If the sign goes is negative, it's a subsidy. Then you add a term here that's always non-negative, right? So that's not something, you know, it's not something that where you get a subsidy. It's always a penalty. And it's just a penalty for deviating here. Okay? So that's the idea. And it turns out this does a lot of things. I mean, and there's a lot of theory about it, which all of which I'm skipping, but this does things like the dual problem now becomes actually smooth and has a Lipschitz constant. So if this means anything to you, that's great. And, you know, so I mean, so this regularizes the dual.
So this is the well-known method of converting of non-constrained optimization of constrained optimization to non-constrained by adding finishing functions.
It's exactly what it is. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, actually, in the end, I mean, I'm beginning to realize all of these methods are the same, including the ones that are being published right now. Right? I mean, maybe there's an epsilon variation, but it turns out, like, all of a sudden, everything starts looking the same because everything is the same in some way. Okay, so. Yeah, but absolutely. So, okay, so the method of multipliers. Oh, by the way, if you like, you can also think of this as the Lagrangian to a modified problem. So the modified problem is, instead of minimizing f of x subject to ax equals b, you minimize f of x plus rho over 2 times this thing subject to ax equals b. And you look at that and you say, well, that's a dumb problem. Clearly, it's equivalent. It's equivalent. Because if you're feasible, ax equals b, the term you've added to the objective is 0. And you'd think, well, this doesn't seem like a good way to go. Or so. Anyway, so you see what I'm saying. But it does have this effect on the dual, and anyway. And we'll see what the difference is. What?
So the effect of the rho is important, I suppose.
No, it's not. No, we'll talk about that. We'll have to define what fine means, but yes, okay, we'll get to that. So you asked about the alphas. It turns out once you do this, the dual has a Lipschitz constant, and you can work out various things. And it turns out there's no question about what the alpha should be. It's just rho, okay? Mm. Now, this is actually a beautiful, this is method of multipliers right here. It is relatively useless as an algorithm for various reasons we'll look at. It is, however, still traditionally taught, I think, out of tradition and things like that. I mean, let's think about what would be required here. It would have to be a problem where, for some reason, it's easy to minimize f plus this quadratic. But for some reason, it was very hard to minimize f subject to an equality constraint or something. I mean, you see what I'm saying here? And in fact, it's not surprising that they're. But it's interesting. Okay. So actually, we can even explain why this rho, why the alpha is rho. And it actually makes clear how these methods work, right? So it looks like this. To minimize f of x subject to ax equals b, these are the optimality conditions. You have to be primal feasible. And you have to have, I mean, this is Lagrange multipliers, right? This is just it. That's it. So this is the dual residual, primal residual. Okay. Now, in the method of multipliers, here's what happens. Xk plus 1 is minimizing this thing, but that's the gradient of this is just, you know, it's the gradient of f, and then the gradient of that other term plus the y, and you write it this way. You stare at it for a while, and you say, oh, hey, look at this. This is yk plus 1 if rho is the step length, okay? And then you realize, oh, and you say, well, the gradient of this is 0. That's how you choose xk plus 1 is to minimize this thing, so the gradient is 0. By the way, I'm doing it for the case where it's differentiable. It's the same if it's non-differentiable, right? So what happens then, what it says is if you use this update, so if that's your step size, then it says that as every step you're producing a primal and a dual pair. Actually, you're producing a primal point and a set of a price vector. It says every time you're doing that, it turns out this is always true. So you have two optimality conditions, primal and dual. And it says the dual one is satisfied exactly every step. And so you're just waiting for the primal one to come into to converge to 0. Okay, so it kind of makes sense. It's nice, right? So this is the idea. And this theme we'll come back to as well. Okay, about the method. Here's the good news. By adding that quadratic regularization, oh, by the way, modern versions of that, you know, it's very unsophisticated to add quadratic. Of course, you'd add a Kullback library, you know, some kind of, you know, Bregman divergence or something, and then then you'd have some like entropy-like thing, and it would look more sophisticated, right? And then you could actually honestly say this wasn't done in 1973. Everybody see what I'm saying here? You could impress your friends and things like that with some obscure thing, and then argue that was better, right? So I just want to mention that. I'm sticking with the conventional quadratic, just because actually, if you get the quadratic, you can go back and replace this with a Bregman divergence. Okay, fine. Here's the good news. Adding that regularization makes this thing go from a very fragile algorithm that doesn't work for many, many problems into one that is absolutely rock solid. There's, I don't know of anything more solid. It's just this.
So what's the intuition behind this robustness for adding this term? There is a
reason for it. Because what it's actually from monotone operators. So let me hold. We'll talk about that later, maybe if we have time. But no, it's by monotone operator theory that tells you that it's got something. Okay, so basically what happens is those functions f, they can be non-differentiable. That's number one. They can take on the value plus infinity. And in fact, most of the interesting cases f will take on the value plus infinity. That's how we're going to encode constraints, right? In fact, f can be a sick function that looks like this. It could be plus infinity almost everywhere except like on some one hyperplane or something like that. There it's zero. I mean, so by the way, when you're doing optimization, these are usually you start to say, oh, it has to be differentiable. Oh, the gradient should be Lipschitz, you know, have a Lipschitz constant L, you know, all this kind of stuff. So this just takes you to the most general function you could ever possibly want. Okay, and it just works. It works. Okay? Now the bad news is what happens is that splitting is now destroyed because everything's coupled by this quadratic, and the whole point was to do distributed optimization. Okay? And now, yeah?
I'm a little bit confused about your comment. So you said that I can stick all the constraints inside the objective because it can take a value.
Absolutely.
But you still are pulling out this AX equals B as kind of a...
That's right. That's right.
Without
yeah.
that, you wouldn't have the Lagrangian or anything. So why is that a special constraint?
Oh, no. It's a great one because what you do is... suppose I have a problem where it's separable, f is separable, and the constraints are separable. Then the separable constraints, I shove them into the f, and it's still separable. Ax equals b is the coupling constraint. And that's why, so it's a great question. That's why you do it. Yeah. You could put the ax equals b into the constraint, solve it in one step, and you would have a very complicated way to say, here's how you should solve your problem. Step number one, solve your problem, right? Then, because that's what would happen, right? Mm-hmm. So. Actually, it'd be even worse than that, because you'd have an extra term in there, right? So that's why. Okay, yeah.
Multiplier sounds like you're adding essentially the integral of your constraint as an additional regularization term.
You're adding...
I mean, to get the AX minus, to you know, that additional term, that's essentially the integral of AX
oh.
minus.
Thank you. Yes, we're going to talk about that. Oh, very good. Thank you. That's we're going to talk about it later. I can say it now. You're exactly right. So, yeah, it's this. This, that's an error, right? Your job here is you're doing price discovery. So you want to manipulate y until that is zero, right? So if you look at this formula, this says that y, k, is the running sum of the errors multiplied by rho, right? So if you know about control, that's integral control. That's been used since 1880 or something like that, right? So was this your point?
I don't know integral control. I was just looking at your the augmented Lagrangian.
Oh.
You know, the last term is the integral of the second term.
It's not, actually. Not quite, because of the y here. Now, by the way, I could put this linear term inside there, and then we could make it just a quadratic. But yeah, actually, yes, it is. It's the integral.
Yeah.
Here, it's the integral over iterations, right? So, yeah. Okay. All right. So the question I thought you asked was an excellent one. yours was also quite good. Okay. So. Now we're going to do, finally we're up to alternating direction method of multipliers. Okay, so the idea is you want something that combines the rock solid properties of method of multipliers, right, with the ability to do decomposition, because that's why we want to solve giant problems, right? So that's the idea. And so, you know, it's explicit in the 70s, and you can even, it was later found to be equivalent to operator splitting methods that were developed in the 50s and stuff. So, I mean, not exactly in the same form, but, you know, so this is not from, you know, NIPS 2 years ago or something, right? So, okay, so here it is, and it's actually very straightforward. Here it is. We're going to split x into just two things. The variable formerly known as x is now x, z. So we have two primal variables, x and z. And We'll just say it splits across two. By the way, in the Russian, in the Soviet literature, right, they split it into K things. We'll find that, by the way, splitting into two is good enough. You don't need to split it into K, right? You'll see why two is good enough. Okay. And then you have a completely general equality constraint linking them. Okay? So there's the augmented Lagrangian. Here are the steps. I mean, it is so dumb. It's this. The method of multipliers, by the way, would do the following. You would minimize this jointly over x and z, and then you do a price update. Okay? Instead, you do a Gauss-Seidel sweep. So you do this. You minimize over x. You get the new x. This is the price vector's locked down. On the next step, you minimize over z, but you use the new value of x. This is a Gauss-Seidel sweep. Then at the end, you count, well, that's the residual. And then this is the running sum of the integral, or that's the integral control term if you know about control. Okay? That's it. Okay? Oh, by the way, this suggests various things, right? If you had time, you could do this three times, right? Or twice, or 17 times, or something like that. And actually, if you did it enough times, that would be Gauss-Seidel, and it'd be back to the method of multipliers, right? So, okay. What?
And we're back in 1600 when Carl Friedrich Gauss published the optimization
paper. Sure. The hint is you're using names like Lagrange, right? So, yeah, that's your other hint that these are not from last year, these methods. Okay. So that's it. By the way, in some sense, the talk is over now. So it's over. That's the algorithm, right? So it just says optimize it. You broadcast a price vector. In one iteration, optimize over one group of variables x. Optimize over z, collect all the parts, see if the residual is zero. If it is, quit because you're done. Otherwise, update the price vector and do it all again. That's it. Okay. All right, I already said all this. Okay.
From that explanation, that row would be very important, right? If your row isn't chosen
reasonably well,
then you don't get good price prediction. Then how could you
make We'll talk about it. We'll get to that. Don't worry. Yeah. What do I need to send to x to z? X, just the value of x has to be known. So let's look at that. Let's actually look at what's involved in this step. If you minimize this over x, that's a constant and it's totally irrelevant, right? So you don't need to even know what g. So this step, let's suppose that's done in one processor, just for fun, right? It doesn't even have to know what g is. It's totally irrelevant because it minimizes f plus this thing plus this thing. And notice that in that step, that's a constant. Okay, period. So in fact, if you could have two separate processors, one handling f and g, and neither knows what the other one is. They don't have to know it. Now, you do have to exchange the values, right? Like if I minimize over x, I have to send a message to you, which is this is x. Or we can get it from shared memory or something like that, right? When you minimize over z, this thing, that's totally irrelevant.
Don't you need the term z for the second, the quadratic thing?
Look, what happens is this. In each step, suppose I'm going to do the x step.
Right.
Then what triggers me to do that is I just got the value of z. So when I calculate, in fact, I don't even need the value of z. I just need bz. So I need bz.
Yeah.
So if I get the value of bz, that's all I need, right? Mm-hmm. Then that's just some vector. It's not, b could be gigantic, but bz is a vector. And a simple assumption, which is reasonable, is that we can pass around vectors. We can't pass around matrices, right? So that's quite reasonable. So you get bz. Once you know bz, you can do this. You don't even have to know what g is. And it flips. When you're doing the z minimization, you don't even have to know what f is. All you need to know is, in fact, specifically the vector ax. So in fact, thank you. That's a better, by the way, very often a and b are like I and minus I and stuff like that. But in fact, now what I'm saying is actually precise and answers your question. Actually, the other one did answer your question, but this is a better answer. So that's what you need to pass ax and bz. You had a question?
Yeah. So that's great, but the updates to x and z and y are still synchronous, right?
True. So I'm going to talk about that later. So there's actually been some stuff done on the asynchronous versions of this. First of all, Google just did it and report that it works. I don't know what works means in that case, but it works in practice. And there actually is some theoretical support for it. I know nothing about that. No, certainly not. No, and actually, the reason it's not trivial to do, normally if you have like a gradient minimization or something like that, asynchronous is fine, because every time you do something, you're reducing something like the distance to the optimum or something like that. This one has a state. Why is a state? A state variable here. And so there's dynamics in this algorithm. And then asynchronous is not at all obvious. So, okay. So, but I'm going to, throughout here, I'm going to assume, yes, it's synchronous. So.
So is this provably equivalent to achieve the same minimum as if you did it, not separably?
These are great questions. These questions are almost at the level where I should be paying people, because that's, I think, the next slide or something like that. But we'll, or it's two slides over. Here. So, yeah. So, let's get that over with now. That's great. So here's the convergence. Ready for the convergence theory of this? It just works. There. That's the convergence theory. If there's a solution, it solves the problem. Period. Just period. Right? No assumptions on A, B, anything. If there's a solution, this converges to it. Period. Now, this is stated very carefully here, right? These are true statements. The this thing goes to zero, that's the primal residual, and the objective value goes to the optimum. Now, I'll tell you some things that are false. Here's would be one. X converges. Z converges. X converges to an optimal point. Well, if the first one's false, this is stronger. Okay, so those are false. Okay?
Is it rare or is it regular?
Actually, I'm going to make a stronger statement than that in a minute. I'll tell you one that is true. Why the dual variable does converge. Okay, that does converge always. Okay, now I'm going to make it's not radical, but it's true. Okay, so by the way, if you want X to converge, you have to have more assumptions. You have to start saying, you have to start talking about ranks and intersections of ranges and null spaces and crap like that. Okay, but I'm going to make a stronger statement, a more provocative one. It's this: that doesn't matter. Totally irrelevant in practice. People get very upset when you say that. Like, excuse me, you're going to run an optimization method and you don't know, you even know there are counterexamples where that variable does not converge? You see what I'm saying? Let alone to an optimal point? Everyone kind of got this? And the answer is absolutely, because it doesn't matter. Here is what actually matters if you run an algorithm like this. You will stop when the residual is small. That is guaranteed to happen. And you will stop when you are near optimal in objective value. And that is guaranteed to happen. Whether or not xk is converging to something is completely irrelevant. Now, what's obviously happening is if xk is going to rotate around and drift, it's obviously drifting around in the optimal set. You know, the optimal set is often, I mean, if it's a singleton, then of course this implies it, right? So, okay.
Yeah, but if f and g has a limit, it's not completely convex, but
I ask that later. That's a great question. But for now, until at the very beginning I had an assumption, the scope of that assumption is these are convex, and until we hit that right bracket, that assumption's enforced, the scope of that. I will talk about, that's a super interesting question, so remind me later what happens when f and g is non-convex. That's absolutely fascinating. So if you forget, somebody else should ask. Okay, so.
One more question.
Yes.
What is the guarantee that will hit the global maximum or minimum?
It's absolute. Here, it will work perfectly. No, exactly in this sense. Do you mean hit it?
Yes.
What do you mean hit? Oh, then it's zero.
It's time to be the global extremum for fx.
That's right.
Fx.
It is. Yeah. So this says you get arbitrarily close. I can tell you the probability that you're going to hit it, zero. But that's completely irrelevant and stupid. I mean, that's not a real question. What?
We have an edge in those functions, which is a well-known deficiency of the Gaussian minimization. It stops out of the global extremum, even if you have one extremum.
Yeah, this doesn't get the global extremum. I'm saying exactly what I'm saying. I'm saying the residual gets small, and you get arbitrarily close to the optimal value. I'm not saying anything more. And in fact, I would argue, you cannot, by definition, care about anything else. If you do, you're making it up. If you care about something else, you better state it in the optimization problem. Because the semantics of an optimization problem, when I walk up to you on the street and say, please minimize F subject to these constraints, okay? Then here is the contract when you solve it. The contract is you return to me something that satisfies the constraints within some tolerance and is within some tolerance of the optimum. And if I say, I don't like your point, it doesn't satisfy this or that, that is nonsense. That's nonsense. That's a different problem, but it's not an optimization problem. Yes?
Is x and z just at random, or are you just doing
something? Oh, that's a great question, too. We're going to get to that. This is going to be fun. You had a question?
About speed.
Yes. Oh, that's a good one too. Okay, so the question is, how does it work? And of course, everyone now is looking at optimal order methods, and is this 1 over t, 1 over square t, you know, blah, this kind of things, right? This is the worst, this has the worst complexity that there is. So, on the other hand, it has to, because it's super duper general. Come on, it handles problems that go to infinity and stuff like that. I mean, this is crazy. There's no Lipschitz constants. If you don't see a Lipschitz, if you grep through something and don't find a Lipschitz constant, then this is the best thing you can get. But in fact, the convergence rate, according to the theory, is the worst you can possibly get. That was your question, right? Okay, good. This is great. Okay. We skipped a couple slides. I don't know that I'll go over quickly just to say what it was. Here it is. It turns out there's the analog of why rho works, and it's actually kind of cool. When the optimality conditions for this problem are primal feasibility, dual, there's really one, but it splits into with respect to x and with respect to z. This is with respect to x, and that's with respect to z. I mean, you stack them, and it's really two. So you have one primal residual, two duals, okay? And note that the two dual residuals can be evaluated on like separate processes if we imagine x and z separated, right? So if you minimize this, it's the same calculation. You go through here, and it turns out that what happens is if you run ADMM with this step length, then this triplet here, these are primal, and then a dual variable, that these things, you get one of the dual conditions for free every step. Okay, and now you're waiting for a primal error to go to zero and a dual. Okay, so I'm just saying that the choice of the step length in the maximizing the dual function is not arbitrary. Okay. One thing to mention here is you get shorter formulas if you do the following. This is a linear function here. This is actually related to your integral question, and that's a quadratic. But I can shove this linear thing into the quadratic. By completion of squares or whatever you want to call it. And it says that I can write this way, like that. And then, in fact, u is nothing but the scaled dual. And then the algorithm looks like this. So it looks like this. You minimize f plus a quadratic. Then you minimize fg plus a quadratic. And then you do the update. Here, there's not even a row. Here, row is like 1. Okay? So. And I should mention a couple. You can think of them different ways. Like up here, you should think of that as a price vector or dual vector. And if you're running a problem where the price vector has an important meaning, like you're doing advertising or you're doing energy stuff, and these are the locational marginal prices or something like this, then you might want. I mean, it's trivial. It's just this change. But this is a nice way to think of it, right? And then so this is sort of the economic term. This is the market term, and that's sort of this weird term that penalizes going away from the market for everybody. This one is actually quite beautiful. Here, you can think of negative u. You can think of as a target for the residual. So what is coordinating everything in this case is you're moving u. And in fact, if mechanically you can think of that as a spring, and so you're moving the point u, and you have a spring tied to it. And you move that, and that spring pulls x and also z. They'll pull it so that this thing is zero, right? So you're going to see formulas like this. We go back and forth. Don't even say anything about it. Yeah.
Would you be pro?
No, we're going to get to that. Oh. You're asking questions. It's not causal, but push that onto a stack, and we will pop it later. So don't worry. Okay. The theory says, here's how you pick row. Ready? Positive. Okay, there. That's done for the theory. Okay, so that's over. And by the way, it says in theory it works for any positive row. Okay, so that there's that answer. You can imagine there's going to be another answer. Right? So I'm actually not going to go over this because it gets kind of boring, but it's related to gazillions of things. Actually, what's very interesting is it turned out only in the 80s, late 80s, was it recognized that ADMM is identical to something called Douglas-Rachford splitting. And that's something that goes back to like the 50s applied to PDEs. So it's actually kind of weird. It's also, it turns out, the same as something called progressive hedging. It's identical to something from the 80s. By the way, you might imagine, why would, these are great people, right? Why would they write make a new algorithm up, and then later would it be found to be the same as this older one? And it's, the algorithm's just complicated enough, you rewrite it a different way, and it has a different form, and it's actually much harder than you think to actually show this algorithm's isomorphic to that one. It's not as simple as you think. Okay, I won't say much more about that. Okay, so what I'm going to do now, actually now we're going to enter a part of the talk that's just kind of, it's quite trippy. So here's the program. The program is this. Now, you know what ADMM is now, so the talk is over. But we're going to design, I'm just going to show you some simple things about what you have to do. Oh, and notice what you have to do. You have to implement exactly one method. If you want, if you take a function f or g or whatever it is, and you have to actually minimize f plus a quadratic. There's no other method. Also, actually, kind of interesting to point out, this method is a higher level method, I would say, than ordinary optimization. In ordinary optimization, what do you have to implement if you want to minimize f, you know, something with f and g, with f, right? The answer is you have to evaluate a gradient or a subgradient, maybe a Hessian, this kind of stuff, right? This is higher order. So the only method we will ever use to access f is going to be, well, we'll give it a name in a minute. It's going to be f dot augmented quadratic minimization. It's going to have a name in a minute. Everybody see this? So, by the way, that can be something that we can do analytically. It could be something where there's actually numerical computation. It could even be heavy lifting. So minimizing that quadratic could actually fire up a primal dual integer point solver and, you know, use 64 gigs of RAM. We'll see. We'll look at all sorts of stuff. Okay. So the idea is this. When you minimize over x, you have to minimize f plus it. And by the way, that's the only thing you have to do. Right, so this will have all sorts of interesting implications when we do machine. You know, if you do machine learning and stuff like that, it'll be quite fast. It'll be very cool. Special cases of this come up often, and then these are worth. And everything I'm going to say is going to be completely trivial. Here's one. If f is block separable and a conformally separates, then that splits into n parallel updates, and that's the reason we're doing all this. Right, is so that we can do this prox. Sorry, I haven't said that yet. Sorry. So you can do this minimization across in parallel. That is the point. Okay. Now, a special case that comes up all the time is A equals I. That says minimize F plus a quadratic deviation from V, a given point V. That's the argument. That's the proximal operator. You could say a ton about that. It's a very cool thing. It comes up all the time. It's actually quite beautiful. It just says basically somehow minimize f plus don't be very far from v. That's all it says. Here are some special cases. F could be the indicator function of a set, of a convex set. That means it's either 0 on the set or plus infinity. By the way, these are not the kind of functions that play nice with optimization, right? It's a function that's 0 everywhere and then goes to plus infinity. Okay? These are the kind of things that would ruin a gradient method, anything conventional, right? Okay, so here, if this is 0 or infinity, if it's 0, if you're in C, then it says minimize this thing. If you're out of C, it's plus infinity. And if you're minimizing, plus infinity is the worst thing there can be. So what it says is, please minimize this thing here, the distance squared to V over points in the set. That's projection. So this thing, if F is an indicator function, this is projection. Right, so everything's going to start looking very familiar. Well, suppose this was like an L1 norm, right? Well, then you can just analytically work this out. And it's soft thresholding, right? That's it basically says subtract a number from it, like lambda over rho or whatever. And then if that change sign, make it 0, another one, you know. So it's a function that looks like this, or I guess for you. Well, here, I'll do it this way. It looks like that. It's flat and that. So I guess in EE, you'd call it a dead zone or something like that. Okay, so, and there's lots of others. There's long literature of these things, and they're not hard. Okay, here's another obvious one. Suppose the function is quadratic, and then you're asked to minimize a quadratic plus a quadratic. Well, a quadratic plus a quadratic is a quadratic. How do you minimize a quadratic? It's called linear algebra. Okay, so that's nice. But there's some really cool things you can do. Here's an important one. This is this. Suppose I'm going to use a direct method, I'm going to factor a matrix like this, right? If I'm going to factor that matrix, then you use the following thing, which, if you know about numerical linear algebra, is kind of cool, but it's this. How much does it cost to solve one set of equations with you know, how much is it? The first time you do this, you have to factor this. You cache the factorization, and every time after that, the cost went down by a factor of the smaller dimension in A. Okay? So this is actually extremely significant, right? Because it just says, you know, if you want to solve, you know, 5,000 by 5,000 matrix, you know, equations, the first time it's going to take you, I don't know, whatever it takes you. That would be, I don't know, I made that up. So, no more, right? It'd be a cube, like five. It'd take you 30 seconds on some machine, right? So it'd take you 30 seconds. After that, you get a discount by a factor of a 5,000. Everyone see this? So what's actually cool, actually, this changes a lot of things, because when the complexity police come around and say, oh, that's so unsophisticated. What? That's a 1 over T method. Oh, my God. You know, we've moved on to, you know, accelerated methods and blah, blah, blah. Right? We all know these people. Right? So what's relevant to point out is that in a situation like that, the cost of an iteration is complete nonsense. Because the first iteration costs you 5,000 times as much as subsequent ones. And what that says is, you know, you don't even have to worry. As long as you're under 5,000 iterations, there's nothing to say, right? And by the way, the first iteration is solving a least squares problem. So we'll get to these more. Yeah.
So some problems have so much fill in, you don't ever want to do a full process.
Oh, absolutely. No,
right.
So you right.
compute a recent preconditioner.
Oh.
But then your update step is an approximate update.
So that's a good question. So the first question is approximate updates. So ADMM works with approximate updates. There, that's the summary. Okay? And so that's that, number one. And number two, iterative methods. If you use an iterative method, what you do is you warm start it from the previous value, or from V, actually. You warm start it from the last point, and then a beautiful thing happens. What happens is when you run CG, and also you can put in the fact that you don't have to solve it exactly. You might do 50 steps, you know, 50, 50, 50, then start doing 30, 30, 30, 10, 20. Then at the end, you're going 2, 2, 2, 2. These are CG steps, right? For obvious reasons, because you're converging. And so what happens is, once again, the number of iterations has nothing to do with the wall clock time, right? So, but that's exact. If you draw the iterations, you say, oh, that's very slow convergence. But then you take into fact that the final ones are costing you 2 CG steps, and the first ones were costing you 50. So
you have a way to link the progress you make on the app with what you do on the one?
That's a great question. So there are some, to be fully honest, right, the results that tell you that it works with approximate minimization basically say that the sum of the suboptimalities has to be summable. Okay? So you'd have to know this. You could do that in CG. My guess is that you wouldn't, so I can tell you what people do. I mean, this is street fighting stuff. It's probably correct, but I honestly don't know that it is. Street fighting stuff is this. You ready? Here, it's a very sophisticated algorithm for doing this. I will do no more than 10 CG steps. Period. That's it. Right? So it just basically says, you know, in minimizing this quadratic, I'm making 10 good steps every time. And I mean, the whole thing is a slow algorithm, so, you know, it works. And things like that appear to work, but I'm actually not aware that anyone has actually proved that or that people are running sort of good, honest methods for doing this. So that's a great question.
I can. So this question, are you aware of any kind of function on F that will give you the, rather than that zone, but give you sigmoid function?
Sure. You can back that up. Oh, I don't know. We'd have to work it out. Yeah. So of course you can. Yeah.
So this one can always go back when you give any kind of nonlinear function.
No,
whatever you want,
no, it has to be. No. It would have to be monotone increasing. And we'll talk about later. We can talk. It has to have some properties, right? So we'll talk about that. Okay. Quadratic. These are tricks, right? Here's another one. Suppose f is smooth, right? Then it says, well, you use your standard methods. If it's small enough, you use Newton. If it's otherwise, you'd use things like limited memory BFGS, and now we're out there solving problems with 10 million variables with like no problem at all. Actually, if you do either CG type things, if you do iterative stuff for solving linear equations, or over here you're minimizing a smooth function, that extra term we added, which is that extra quadratic, should bring warmth to your heart. Because when you do something like LBFGS or CG, what you're worried about is things like condition numbers. Actually, what you're really worried about is minimum curvature. So If you run BFGS on, you know, some logistic thing without any regularization, it's not even going to work, right? Because it's, I mean, it would work in theory, but it's silly. Everybody see what I'm saying? You add quadratic regularization, and that tames these things right up. So it's not just that you're minimizing something smooth. You're minimizing something that's smooth plus a quadratic. And people who do iterative methods of any kind for smooth things, this makes them super happy, and for good reasons. Everybody got this? So, okay. All right. Now, all we're going to do is we're going to assemble. Now we just do assembly job. And actually, this will show you how you represent things. And it's hilarious how simple it is, right? So I claim you know everything you need to know now, everything. Now watch this. Let's start with just silly little stuff. So we're going to do this. We're going to minimize a function subject to it being in a constraint set. And so here's how you write it for ADMM. And these splittings typically are ridiculous. This is a good example. So here it is. What I'm going to do is, let's suppose f is smooth or something. I don't know. Let's make it smooth. Okay, let's make it logistic loss. Okay, so it's smooth. All right? Then, and this is some constraint set. I don't know what it doesn't matter, right? So what happens is you rewrite it this way. F of x plus g of z subject to x minus z equals, this is just x equals z. So, I mean, if someone walked up to you and said, please help me solve this problem, you would say, like, what are you talking about? That's the same as that. And why would you write it this way? It's ridiculous, right? Oh, by the way, the name for this is, you would say in going from here to here, you have replicated the variable x. And you've added, that's called a consistency constraint. So you cloned x to a new variable called z, and you added a constraint that says it's a new version, but it has to be the same. We're going to get to this in a more general context. Everybody got this? But what's cool is this. You will only handle f or g at one time. Handling g actually is a projection. Handling f is a, let's imagine f is smooth. It's actually doing a smooth minimization. So for example, if you want to minimize a smooth function over a polyhedron or whatever it is, over some box, you got a beautiful method for it now. You run limited memory BFGS here with warm start. And down here, you clip the entries. And you have a method that's going to work and work really well. Okay? This will solve LPs, QPs, everything, just immediately, right? You just throw in the parts. Okay.
So the question here. Earlier, I thought that so just by looking at that problem formulation, x
this
and
one.
Z are symmetric. You can do, you know, the order.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
But in this particular case, you won't be
No. Actually, you could relabel f and g, right, in ADMM. And you'll actually get a different algorithm. It's not quite the same.
Exactly. Which one is easier? Which one is better in that case?
No one knows. No one knows. They typically perform about the same, but they're not the same algorithm, and they're different. And there's even a form of ADMM that's symmetric, and so it's more aesthetic. So I'll tell you what that is. That goes like this. You do an X minimization, and then you update the dual variable by half the amount. Then you do a Z minimization, and you update by half amount. And the aesthetics of that, I think, we all agree, right? That's much prettier. And now, by the way, if I switch X and Z, it is isomorphic, right, too, because the odd steps become equal to the even steps. But in this one, you switch F and G, and you could do it right here. Yeah. And you'd get a different algorithm. It would also involve exactly one projection per step and one smooth minimization. And it would be a different algorithm. Generally, they work about the same, but in fact, no one really knows, as far as I know.
So the first formulation is like a general convex optimization problem.
This
right?
one.
So are you suggesting that every convex optimization problem I should solve it this way?
No.
Instead of
I already said this. I already said that for ADMM, I would say something like this. For any particular problem, there will be one or many methods that are superior to this. What this is these are the Lego bricks that if I said here, you know, it's one of these imaginary things, you're on a desert island, but fortunately you have your laptop and you know, a couple of key libraries, and then you have to solve one of these problems and have to assemble it, this would be an awfully good way to do it. That's all I'm saying. So I'm not suggesting this. Something like this will work really well for certain things, right? I mean, this will be competitive or at the state of the art. And if you put code time in there too, it will be code development. Yeah?
So initially, the row is setting as a small value and then increasing.
Nope. Row is constant. Right, it's constant. You can change it, and in many implementations you do. We'll get to that when we answer the dreaded how do you choose row question. We'll get to that. But in fact, here we're just assuming it's constant. Yeah. Okay. So everybody cool on this? And the key part is This says I can solve a constrained minimization problem provided I have a method for minimizing f plus a quadratic and then projection. Okay? So, okay. Lasso, that's, it's a modern regression method. So you want to minimize least squares. Notice that's quadratic and then an L1 plus an L1 thing. Okay, so fine. You split it. Again, look how ridiculous the splitting is. You just replicate x. But basically, you have to think about what you're doing here when you split is you're saying, I want one processor to handle this, and I want another one to handle that. But that falls, that's one of our special cases. That's minimizing a quadratic. That's also a special case because, you know, the prox function, the prox operator on that is soft thresholding. And now I assemble the two. And notice that you could even, if you want, you could even have completely separate processors handling the soft thresholding. And I mean, it's silly, but handling the soft thresholding and the linear part. And so here's what you get. You get something that looks like this. Soft thresholding, this is trivial, and then this update. Here's an interesting thing. This thing, that's ridge regression. Because this is actually solving least squares plus, and then a row over two times, this is taken off regularization, right? So, and not only that, suppose you cache. This says, here's how you do lasso. First, do ridge regression. Cache the factorization. Now you get a big discount, steep discount. I mean, unless it's sparse enough or whatever, but if it's dense enough, you get a steep discount on subsequent iterations. And it says, go with the cheap disk. Now you iterate with the cheap, with the back solves. Okay? So.
How do you turn that into ridge regression? I can't see that directly. Because
this? Because if I minimize norm AX minus B squared plus rho. Right. So here's what's bizarre. This says by iteratively solving a sequence of ridge regression problems, I'm actually solving a lasso problem. That's the naive way to say it. But then someone says, how many iterations it take? And you say, I don't know, 200. And you go, well, that's kind of a lot. And then you say, but if you solve a sequence of ridge regression problems and you cache the factorization, you're going to get a huge discount after the first step. Okay? So that's what this is saying.
And at the end, it will be comparable to the...
It won't be comparable. It'll be exactly the same. No, we're solving. This is not a heuristic. We are solving that problem exactly. Okay? So, all right. Let's do a lasso example. And these are just like trivial little things. These are implemented. I mean, this is a MATLAB with like some ridiculous, you know, four-line script. It's not optimized in the slightest. So it's just a, a little problem with 1,500 examples and 5,000 features or something like that. And you just type in a three-line script. I mean, look. You don't need it. We don't need it. The world does not need a new lasso solver, right? I mean, what do we have? I mean, my group's written three. Actually, if you draw within 200 meters of my office, it would include the stat department and the CS department, and now we've got like 10 different implementations of lasso. So we don't need another one of these, that's for sure. But look, you just turn the crank on these methods, and here's what happens. The factorization is 1.3 seconds. Subsequent iterations, by the way, there should have been a discount factor of about 1,000. And this is, you can see, way off. It's 30 milliseconds. But I mean, come on, this is MATLAB, and so it's a joke anyway. So, I mean, if you want to do that, if you want, either do it real or don't complain about the times, basically. So this is just to give you the flavor of it, right? So the point is it's a lot faster. Notice also that somebody coming around and saying, like, oh, that's a lot of iterations you're doing. But the point is, it's kind of irrelevant when the first iteration is 1 second and the subsequent ones are 30 milliseconds. It's something to bear in mind. So if you do a lasso solve, that's about 3 seconds. You know, that's on the same. I mean, it's for a very short three-line script, that's pretty good. And actually, it goes back to this really cool idea. It says, you know, if you look at, like, lasso and you say, why would you not do that? If you were to talk to a classical person in statistics, they'd say, well, fine, I mean, we might like to do that, but there's no there's an analytical solution to ridge regression or ticking off regularization. There's an analytical solution, and there's not one for lasso. It doesn't make any difference. It's the same cost. It's the same. Here's another one. Suppose you did the full regularization path. So you take 30 lambdas. You cache the factorization of A once, because the only thing that will change in the soft thresholding. And then it takes you, so that's really 4.4 divided by 30. And now you're actually substantially beating you're beating ridge regression or ticking off regularization. Everybody? So it's just a baby example. It's not supposed to be, okay. So we'll do one a little bit more interesting just for fun. Again, just to show you that you just turn the crank on these things. And I won't go into the details too much because I'm behind. But OK, so here it is. You have an empirical covariance matrix. And what you want is you want to estimate sigma inverse, and you want this to be sparse, right? So it's conditional independence and stuff like that. So this is what you want. And so what you do is you form the negative log likelihood function. That's this here. That's x is what you're looking for. X is going to be sigma inverse. That's the given data. And then this, to encourage sparsity, you put an L1 norm here. And this is the sum of the absolute values over the whole matrix, right? OK, so fine. And you know, this is relatively recent. You know, this is like, I don't know, 5 years ago or something like that. People were looking at this and writing papers about it. So we're just going to apply ADMM, but you know, vanilla ADMM. What you do is you want to minimize this. And notice what we've done. We've taken this part and this part. We said, well, those are smooth in X. So we'll lump those together. And that we know how to do, right? So then you get something like this. You have to minimize this thing. Now, that's smooth. And you might imagine you could use something like LBFGS. It turns out this is you can solve this analytically. And the reason is they're spectral functions, right? Everything here is invariant under a change of coordinates. So you just orthogonalize it, and it splits. You get an analytical solution. And the rest are very simple things, right? So it turns out what you do is you do an eigen decomposition. And then actually, you're computing this function of the matrix, actually. And then you get that. So the cost of the X update is an eigen decomposition. And then you run it. And what's embarrassing is it's kind of in the ballpark. This is something where you just take this silly algorithm, type in three lines of something, and you're kind of in the ballpark of a lot of these methods. And actually, some of them scale way. This actually scales way better than some of the other ones. So I mean, it's kind of weird. These are the ideas. I mean, the numbers you shouldn't take seriously. Just the fact that there may be minutes, seconds, hours would be significant here. Yeah.
Can you play the same trick with catching the eigen decomposition and starting that?
You could. Yes. So you could do all sorts of crazy stuff here. No. This is just cold start.
Okay.
We're doing the normal thing, right? We reduce it to whatever it is up, tri-diagonal, and then blah blah blah. So just calling eig. Yeah. Just so it's all of these could be hugely improved. OK. Now we go back to what we started the whole thing about, which is distributed optimization. All right? So, and we'll start with what I think is the simplest distributed optimization problem there is. And it's actually a very good thing to start with, because if you don't know how to do this, then you don't know how to do distributed optimization, more general cases for sure, right? And actually, this covers a lot of things. It's really dumb. It's this. Choose x to minimize a sum of functions there. Okay. The idea is you want each agent or process or thread to handle one of these functions. By the way, this fi, because we're not afraid of things going to plus infinity, these could be constraints too, right? So for example, I mean, this is the kind of thing we've been doing. Fi could encode constraints. In fact, one of the f's could be all the constraints, right? Non-negativity could be one of the constraints. And whatever you like. So it looks like that. And if you want to put this in a machine learning problem, this is beautiful. This is very simple. X is a vector of parameters in a statistical model. Okay? So it's weights in a logistic, regression thing. Doesn't matter, right? Weights in a regression, something like that, right? Then this is the negative log likelihood function or the loss function for the ith block of data. So you might have n data stores. And this is the loss function for parameter x on that data store. Everybody got this? This says, it's as if this says, please collect all the data together and find the joint maximum likelihood estimate. Now you can throw in a regularizer, prior, whatever you like. OK. So in ADMM form, again, the splitting is ridiculous. It looks like this. The first thing you do is you let each block have its own opinion of what x is, right? You replicate. And then you said everyone can have their own opinion, and then you add the constraint that all opinions must agree, right? So this is called, that's called the local variable. That's called the global one. And then these are called consensus constraints. And now you could literally say, if someone says, what is your algorithm doing, or what is this algorithm doing? And the answer would be something like this. Well, I have all these entities. They all have their local opinion about what x is. And what they're doing is occasionally they talk to each other, and they're being pulled into consensus. When they're pulled into consensus, they've actually solved this gigantic problem which would have been the result had they collected all of their data in one place and solved it. Everybody got it? So I mean, I think it's very, yeah. And the math is actually not that hard, so it's actually, but it's more interesting thinking about, like, you know, how these things work and what they mean. Okay, consensus optimization, you just turn the crank, it just pops out beautifully. There's a Lagrangian. So all of these are just, each block does it separately. You minimize your function, your local function plus a quadratic. Then the next step is you minimize this over z, but over z, I mean, it's minimizing a sum of squares. It's the average, so you average. And then you update. But it's even easier, because it turns out this sum is 0, which is also very easy to show. And so the algorithm turns into two lines, and it's just absolutely beautiful. It's this. So here's how you coordinate a bunch of entities minimizing a sum. Nothing could be easier. What you do is each one should minimize its local private function plus the current dual variable. That's the usual economic interpretation. Plus, this is a deviation from deviating from what the average was at the last step. And if you think about it, if we have a bunch of people all solving some problem, and I send a message to everybody, I broadcast a message that says, stop, time's over, that's it, what's x? My best guess of x would be to average all of those. And the reason, that's because for convex optimization, you average, things get better. So that, if I had everybody here had their own private data and you're fitting a logistic model, and I said, stop, and I collected all your data, I should average those weights, right? And then that's guaranteed to be better. Yeah.
It seems somewhat surprising that the averaging weights wouldn't be sensitive to the level of contribution of each term.
Oh, no, that's in there. Oh. That's built into here.
Oh, I see.
So if you have 10 data samples, your loss function is really tiny. If you have 100 million data samples, your FI is really big, or rather it goes up steeply, right? So what will happen is, if your FI is small and weak, the local opinion will pull you far. This term will dominate, and you won't, do you see what I'm saying?
That's yeah. If you have a few rounds of exchange.
No, this is the way it just works. Each time, but you don't know, you see what I'm saying?
You won't be able to move as much because you're...
Yeah, because your loss, your FI, if you've got a small amount of data, your FI is kind of very shallow and small. And that means this term is going to really influence your choice. If you're some giant server and you've got just a billion examples of data, and you're quite certain, you don't even really care about what the other people think, that says your F is centered at the maximum likelihood point, maximum likelihood point, and then, well, that's the Fisher information. If it's smooth, it goes up very steeply. And that says that when you solve this problem, you barely budge from your private opinion. So actually, that is built in there. That's a good question. Okay? All right. So, and it's cool. It has, it's a gather and a scatter. Actually, it's not. Of course, it's an all reduce is what it really is. So it's not a scatter gather. It's an all reduce. Right? So, okay. So that's it. It's kind of cool. Right? Oh, and then that's the error. This is the error at the ith box. It's basically, it's how much your opinion differs from the common opinion. And then it says you should update your dual variable, which is going to help drive your opinion towards the consensus value. It's very intuitive. What's not obvious is that this always works, period. Always works, no matter what f is. F can be plus infinity. Has to be convex. But OK, so yeah.
So if you had a server with like a billion rows of data, and then you had a million smaller machines, each with a few rows.
Yeah.
What would that look like?
It'd work just perfect.
I mean, would the one, because the sum of the smaller ones maybe should pull the big server.
It would all just work. You can check. What's very important is that FI is not the average loss on your set of examples. The scaling has to be done exactly correctly. It's the total loss. And then it works. If you do if you're just used to solving something, we'd all always talk about average law, the empirical loss plus the regularizer. If you do that here, disaster, total disaster, because then someone with 10 samples has the same status as someone. And it's just wrong. You don't add, if I want to do, what do they call this? Like something collaborative filtering, or I don't know. Estimating a parameter from different data stores. You don't add up the average losses. You add up the total losses, and then you, yeah. So no, I promise you, it's going to work perfectly. It'll do just what it's supposed to do.
That probably will just better design to slow your convergence.
Yeah,
you would put them into two giant machines, they will cover it super fast.
Yeah. So actually, we're going to talk about like exactly this problem and how you should do things.
So this method is a little more sophisticated than the naive one typically, you know, many people try. So at the end, you average all the parameters.
Yeah, yeah. And well, I know what some people do. Yeah, I can't say who it is, but I know what they do. They actually they do the first step without this. Each data store calculates its own thing.
That's the most naive way you can do it.
Then they do the following. They collect the weight vectors.
Yeah.
It's sparse. They're sparse. Yeah. They don't quite agree. Yeah. They average them and then do soft thresholding. Period.
Yeah.
Okay. That's what they do.
Yeah.
And actually, it's kind of cool because I looked at it and I said, yes, congratulations. You're doing actually 1.5 steps of ADMM. And all this would say is, listen, if you wanted to, you could do it. I mean, they don't need to because they said it's actually working perfectly well, thank you.
That naive approach doesn't take into account this consensus.
Yeah.
Well, what's interesting about what you're saying is that, in the discussion I had earlier, if it's the case that you have roughly equally distributed nodes, right,
mm-hmm.
you'd probably be okay by throwing away that extra term.
Yes.
Because it just kind of works out.
Yes.
But if they're imbalanced, you mm-hmm. really need it to keep you, you know, kosher.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah.
So
you mean this term.
Might be getting something that works kind of
yes.
by mistake.
Yes, that's it. Yeah. So actually what's very cool about this is if you think about, let's put this is of course general, right? But let's think about it in a statistical learning context, right? That's the negative. Then it says if I have to coordinate a bunch of boxes that have access to data, heterogeneous data even, I mean, it doesn't matter. If I want to coordinate them to get the global maximum likelihood, each one has to implement exactly one method. They have to minimize their negative log likelihood plus a quadratic function. Quadratic function is the negative log density of a Gaussian. This is Gaussian map. So that says that the only thing I would have to do if we want to estimate a statistical parameter is everyone has to support one method, Gaussian map. That's it. And the only thing that will happen is I don't care how much data you have. I don't care what your data is. I couldn't care less. You could be prior. It doesn't matter. You could be one box could be prior. All that happens is I send you a Gaussian, a mean in. You calculate Gaussian map, I don't even care how you do it. Use your custom method that people put a lot of time in, except now they have to go back in and put in the hooks to add the quadratic term, right? But that's trivial in all real methods. And then that comes back. And then then using that just by averaging, I can actually coordinate a whole bunch of things. The only method you've implemented is Gaussian map. You can actually force them to compute the maximum likelihood estimate had they collected all their data in one place. So, yeah.
In the linear term. So you have like solve my problem and don't diverge from the
that's this,
consensus.
Right. That's solve your problem. That's don't diverge from the last round.
And there what
that's the history.
That's
history of how biased you are.
That's exactly what it
is. Lopsided from the mean.
That's right.
Right?
This is state and it's history, it encapsulates the state, it's the integral of the errors, it's the thing that should skew your opinion to make you fall into consensus.
So it says like
that's exactly what it is.
Over the past, you've underestimated the.
Yeah. So
that's what I mean.
Compensate for bias as well.
That's
as
right.
Render splitting.
Absolutely.
Your split just gives you a certain bias.
That's exactly right. And this and what's nice, the bias it goes away.
Yeah.
In the end, you get the global solution. Okay. So let's do a quick example. We'll do a consensus classification. It's a So I'll go quickly because I think people here know about all this, but we're just going to do a little SVM or something like that problem for fun, and I'll just show you how this looks. Oh, we're just going to split the data. This is a tiny baby problem, right? We're going to do SVM, so you have hinge loss, and I have two features and 400 samples, so I could solve that problem in 60 microseconds, literally, right? But instead, I'm going to split it up into 20 groups, and I'll do it in an evil way. Each group gets either all spam or all positive or all negative examples, okay, period. So each group alone has a hideously skewed view of the world, right? So, and they have to coordinate to do this. Okay, so here's what happens. Here's some data. These are all the first classifiers. Well, of course, they're terrible because every single one of these has seen a ridiculously skewed view of the world, okay? That's, then you average, that's that, which is actually, I mean, this is kind of like bagging or something, right? You take some a bunch of terrible weak classifiers. Anyway, so there it is. Now you run ADMM. That's five steps, okay? And then that's 40. And that is, in fact, the solution. Now, what you want to think about this, what is so cool is what's actually happening. You're making an SVM classifier, and I show you 20 examples. They're all positive. Okay, that's all that happens. So the only thing that happens is you go back into your SVM and you put this Gaussian prior. Okay, and the only thing you implement, the only thing you expose to the outside world is the ability for someone to send a message to you that said this is the prior on the weight vector, and then I don't care how much data you have, what data you have, I couldn't care less. You send me back the map estimate. Okay, what's that? No, that's stored locally. That state is stored locally. That's internal. Yeah. It's no one's business.
But in that particular
the case, YI is actually only his business,
yeah,
right?
In that case, I might as well throw away my data because that doesn't tell me anything.
Oh no! Oh, not at all. No. What's going to happen is after 10 steps of this. By the way, you have absolutely no idea who else you're cooperating with. You could be sitting next to someone who has a billion examples all over the place. Okay? You could be sitting next to someone who has one example. It doesn't matter. You just support that one method, which is this Gaussian map thing, and it works. So it's kind of cool. Yeah?
It's great. I feel like I'm being sold this pre-OP.
No. Oh, no, no. No. I'm gonna say, I already told you this is like, for any given thing, there's definitely a better method. I've already told you that. And we haven't even, there's all sorts of things we haven't popped off the stack, like how do you choose row and all sorts. We're getting there. I told you it had the absolute worst complexity in theory. So,
common pitfalls or limitations?
Yeah, we'll talk about that. It's not over. We're not. It's not over. This is not over. This is not over.
In terms of one processor.
What?
You're talking about those limitations in terms of one processor getting worse.
Oh, I can take limitations on many too. Oh, yeah. Let's talk about that. Okay. So
you haven't talked anything about whether you need to randomize the splitting of the data.
Oh, that's a great question. We're going to talk about that too.
Yeah.
No, that's a great question. We're going
to
talk about that. No, we're going to talk about that. Okay. So. Oh, so actually, maybe what I'll do is just to say that, you know, this would not be for solving problems you can solve in 60 microseconds. So you can solve real problems with it, and it does. The cool part is it does kind of the right thing. I'm just for time, because I want to talk, these are all very interesting things. You know, you just write, this is all the source for this is online. It's all super simple and hideously non-optimized. But you get something that it comes out with what you expect to happen, right? That basically, you take a big problem, and this is not big, this is a small one, but this was only limited by EC2 charges on my credit card or something like that. So, but it's the same thing. I mean, that's the factorization time. That's if you knew how to solve a least squares problem of that size in parallel, and you knew what you were doing on 80 cores. If you do that, it takes 5 minutes. And then lasso, it's like 5 or 6, right? Okay, so maybe what I'll do is I'll skip, or maybe, no, I won't. Maybe this would be a great time to say a little bit about how there was a. We have a whole bunch of questions that are pushed on a stack. I'm going to pop one now. So one was, how do you split data? And here's what's weird, that you can make a reasonable argument. And I know people who've actually done both things. So here's one that's very cool. Suppose we're doing machine learning and data fitting. So it's literally that problem we were just looking at back here. It's this thing, right? Okay. So here's one thing you could do. You hash the examples. So let's suppose I have a billion examples. I split it into 100 groups of 10 million. Did those multiply out right? OK, fine. If they don't, then fix one of the numbers to me. Anyway, so that's fine. OK, got it? So now the idea is I have 100 opinions. Let's do logistic regression. I mean, it doesn't matter. I'm making a click-through thing, you know, predictor. OK, it doesn't matter. So here's what happens. I ask each one to go ahead and make a prediction, okay? Now, by the way, you know, those are probably pretty good, right? Because if 10 million examples is not enough to give you a reasonable classifier, you're in deep trouble and you should probably just go home, right? So what you get now is 100 pretty good opinions, right? Now what happens is the only thing that happens when you run ADMM is you're gaining statistical power. That's the only thing that happens. So what happens is, you collect all of these together, you get an average. I mean, by the way, if all 100 are totally different, it's time to quit, because you're not going to get a good classifier anyway. But if they're all about the same, you know, I mean, they're going to be a little bit different. You know, this was from a server in the Northeast, and so people had slightly different click through. You know, that's fine. You collect all these things together. You know, you do this averaging, you do an all reduce. They get it, and what'll happen is those things typically converge in 5 to 10 steps, and the data didn't move. If you see what I mean, right? And so that's an example where probably the right way to distribute it is to hash it, right? I mean, unless it's already sitting in different places, right? So it's naturally already segregated. But there you literally I just randomly send out examples, right?
No, but the theory tells you you don't need to do any of those. Right? No, it works.
The theory says it always works, but I mean, come on, that doesn't mean anything.
The theory says it converges. It doesn't say it will converge faster or slower depending on your initial partition.
Exactly. So that's one extreme where you partition just randomly. The other extreme is you actually do real partitioning so that you get a whole bunch of stuff that has mostly these features, and there's a whole ton of features you've never even seen. You get some other features. And there's a bunch you haven't seen. Now, what happens there is the local problems you solve, you can solve much faster because they're much smaller. Okay, but the problem is, to gain any reasonable estimate, there's a diffusion mechanism that has to happen, and you have to come to. So then these two, you have to balance these two things: simpler subproblems, but many more iterations to come to get a useful solution. And so I would say right now it's completely unclear which is the best way to do it, and it's going to depend on all sorts of like systems issues and things like that and all that. So I really don't know.
But in a case that was really separable like that, shouldn't it be the case that most of the variables that were being regularized on your behalf were the ones you weren't really dealing with in your partition anyway?
Yes. Okay, so there's one step up. This is the most basic thing. This is called consensus optimization. That's where everybody has all variables. But in fact, if we split it up and there's a billion features, and you only have a million of them, and you have a million, then what you really do is that's general form consensus. That's what we call something like general form. You make it a bipartite graph. So you don't handle a billion. You only handle the weights for the features you have. And then in fact, it sounds like it fits perfectly with MapReduce because it does. What happens then is you just take all these things. Your weights you store as key-val pairs. I reduce them all. And if you have a key that matches your key, it means you guys had a common feature, and I average your vals. You know? Okay, yeah. So actually, and this gets us to how these things don't work. I know of no implementation of MapReduce where this is not a total disaster. But that's apparently due to how schedulers work and things like that. But it sure sounds good. That's obviously not a fundamental thing. So, okay, now we could there's one more example I was going to do, or one more topic. It's short. Is that consent?
Yes.
That's consent. Okay. Got it. We're going to do it. I'll go fast, right, because we're almost done with a lot of this stuff. Oh, yeah. Which you want to do one more problem, or you want to do, we can fit in both. Don't worry. I'm not going to go anywhere. But at three, I am. So until three, we can talk about it. Okay, let's do it. Okay, let's look at this. But yes, don't worry, we're coming back to your row question. Okay, so exchange ADMM is this. That's not the problem. So that's the problem there. So here it is. It's actually the dual of consensus. It says this: minimize a sum of fi of xi. These are all different things. Subject to, instead of x, all the xi's equal to zero, they sum to zero. And it's exactly, that's the dual. I can tell you why. Because if you stack the x's, to say that you're in consensus says you're in the range of the matrix I, right? To say that you satisfy exchange says you're in the null space of the transpose, which is I, looking like this, right? So these are, in fact, duals. This has a beautiful economic, in fact, this is what a market is, period. So here it is. F is like a negative utility or a cost. Xi is the vector of, it's a multi-commodity market. Xi is the vector of things that agent I is either going to put into the market or pull out, right? So that's what it is. This says the market clears. This says that for every commodity, the total amount contributed to the market will balance the total amount taken out, okay? This is the, you know, something like, if this was a negative utility, this would be like the negative total social good or social, that's a social cost, okay? And then this thing is the equilibrium or market clearing constraint. And by the way, the dual variable is actually a set of prices, right, for the commodities. It's the commodity prices, okay? So that's it. Now, if you work out what exchange ADMM is, you get a beautiful thing. It looks very simple. It looks like this. Or an unscaled form, it looks like that. This, and here, you'd probably put an unscaled form because that has a beautiful, that's the prices. What's kind of cool about this is if you remove this term here and put that back to alpha k, this is actually a very famous old algorithm from, I guess it's the De Broglie something or other. You know, this is, it's called, it's a tâtonnement procedure. It's a price, it's a price algorithm form. It's arrow. That's it. That's what it is. It's the arrow De Broglie or something. Yeah, arrow. There's a bunch of them. Okay, but this is early. And by the way, that kind of, it kind of worked in theory and it sort of, and doesn't, you'd have lots of things about the Fs that you'd have to assume about, you know, well, they did it with maximizing, so you'd have to say that they were strict, smooth and strictly concave and all sorts of other crazy stuff. This works when these are just always works, period. It'll clear any market. Oh, sorry, if there's a solution. If there's not a solution of it, then, you know, it does, then actually the prices diverge, but that's another, okay. So it's a tâtonnement process. And I just want to look at one quick example of this. If you look in distributed dynamic energy management, so here you take a bunch of devices, they're going to exchange power at different times. And those are actually different commodities, right? So power between 2 and 2:15 p.m. is different from power between 2:45. I mean, they're measured in the same units, which is joules, but they're different commodities. And so what you do is you have each device has a cost of the profile. That also gives you the constraints. And that says that energy has to balance in each time period. And so you do exchange ADMM. And what you're doing now is, it's actually kind of cool. So it's like a smart, it is a smart grid. You're a refrigerator, you're a generator, you're a load or something like that. You're the HVAC system. And what happens is each of them privately optimizes their energy consumption and generation. Completely, you're a storage device, so it's actually subtle for you. You should be charging when the price is high, and you should be discharging when it's low. Did I get that right? No, I reversed it. Okay, fine. Sorry. All right. Anyway, so the idea then is all that happens is you don't even know if he's a battery or not. We don't know that you're an HVAC system. All that happens is the node that clears things tells you what the current primal residual is, which is how much we're violating the energy balance, and we know the current prices. And then we would all update. And actually, we're kind of doing this in the subjunctive, right? Because we're saying, oh, if those are the prices and everything, here would be my profile. And then these would be averaged together. By the way, if they average out to zero, done. That's it. We've solved the problem. And none of us knows how many others were connected to the network, right? So it's kind of cool. So just to give a rough idea, this is something where you really do, these things actually do work. So we implemented these things for various things. We did some fun stuff. You get, this is an example with about a million variables in the optimization problem. And it's something you can solve centrally in hours, so you can find out. And I think that, I forget what this was, but it was kind of seconds. But the scaling is sort of fun. So this was just really simple things. This was, I think these are problems with, I think, 30 or 40 million variables. Because these are something like, I forget what this is like 300,000 devices. You're scheduling over 50-minute intervals for a day. You know, a generator or anything else would have like a couple hundred variables and involves transmission lines and constraints. That's actually a serious, that's a big problem. That's not a, these are not small problems. And those are being solved in a couple of minutes. And this is just on a 32-core machine, which this is just 64 threads. Right, so this is where it actually worked, right? You just make a thread pool and use OpenMP, and it just worked. On more complicated platforms, it doesn't work at all, by the way. So, yeah?
Another angle that I thought you were getting at with the energy one that seems important is that this is a really interesting way to do privacy preserving
yes.
learning.
Yes, right,
so. Store all the information locally.
Right, so when you do this sort of stuff, you can imagine doing stuff like, let's do statistics with medical data. You have a whole bunch of patients, you have some. You better not have just one, right? That's not good. But you have 50, you have 150, 200. And then when you're doing this, basically, you just support one protocol. I end up with a classifier regression model. But you don't know. You don't actually even know how many patients he has. So this is privacy preserving, and I do say that. But I had to stop. I stopped saying it when it turned out there are people in the audience who know about privacy. Because it turns out it actually doesn't satisfy the most basic rules of privacy preserving. I mean, in theory, I could figure, because if I keep querying you, like I'd say, oh, yeah, you know, what if this was the prior? And you tell me what is. Eventually, I can learn your loss function or something. But it would seem as a practical matter that it would, in fact, be privacy preserving. But notice this is severely qualified because this is being taped.
Well, if you reduce the number of iterations, there's only so much information.
See, that's it. So, by the way, I brought this up with my friends who do privacy, and they looked at me and they're like, are you done? And I said, yeah. And they said, no, that's not called privacy preserving. Yeah. And they said, yeah. So, yeah. So, yeah. So, but I agree with you totally. That's a completely reasonable thing. If you have 1,000 patients and we converge in 50 steps, right? I mean, 50 is more than enough for one of these things because, I mean, you're in the Southeast and you have more people with, I don't know, you know, diabetes or something, fine. So it's going to be slightly different than, you know, you've got Northern California and people are healthy there. I don't know, whatever it is, right? But the point is 50 steps is more than enough to get the common model. So in 50 steps, there's no way I can say, ooh, guess what I just found out, you know. So I agree. So, okay. Yeah. So, okay, so I'll just do the conclusions, but we've kind of hit them all. And then, yes, don't worry. It's coming. So, you know, basically, it's the same as or close to literally many methods with other names. It's been around for a long time. And actually, it's kind of fun because you just like Lego-like, you just put bricks together, and you can implement, you know, things that can be shockingly close to competitive with almost nothing. But actually, what's kind of cool is how gracefully it extends to distributed and other computation platforms. Right. So, and I should say one thing, just in case you think you're being sold something. I have to say, actually, that, I mean, things like this have been implemented in the last couple of years on a bunch of things. Some have worked, the dynamic energy stuff on a little MPI, tiny little MPI box with a bunch of cores. People are doing the big thing with gigantic things split 100 ways, the example I just gave you. That's working and running. There's a Pragel implementation that works. But basically, most of them have not. But just for reasons involving modern computation platforms and things like that. So, I mean, they're just not optimized for things like this. And, you know, you'd look at something and it'd spend all its time serializing, deserializing data. And then you'd tear your hair out and you'd say...
They don't work in that they're too slow or they don't get the right... Or they don't converge.
Oh, no, they converge fine. But you do the arithmetic and you say it should be 100 milliseconds per iteration. And it turns out it's 10 minutes per iteration. And then you figure out what's happening, and most of the time it's like serializing, deserializing data. And you're like, you're pulling your hair out because you're saying, the whole point of this is that data should stay there. And they go, oh, yeah, we know how to give the scheduler a hint on that. And I say, well, give it a hint, and then I don't know. So anyway, you get the, no, these things will work out, but just full honesty, some of these look like they should just work.
Exchange problem, that's the scaling, that should.
Oh, no, that one works. that I can assure you, yeah.
It's mainly CPU bound,
no.
So it doesn't have to spend time.
Yes, yes, our little thing is on a shared memory, 64 threads running up. So
but you
sure,
can do a lot
yeah, term, yeah. Well, the real trick is that we use code generation to be able to solve the device problems in microseconds. Okay, that's the real trick. That's also been implemented by Google. That one, the dynamic energy thing on real separate processors, right? And it works. So, and it's even asynchronous. So it works. I mean, roughly.
That's a convex problem to begin with. Huh?
Yes, it is.
So you promised
yeah. No, but first we're going to go, I'll be in big trouble. I won't even be able to make it out the door. There's an escape path right there. So we're going to talk about rho. So the question is, does rho affect the convergence rater? And the answer is yes, of course it does. It turns out if you scale the data appropriately, there's values of rho that are reasonable. There's also some interesting methods where the key, as in curiously in a lot of other algorithms, the key is to balance the rate of decrease of the primal residual with the dual, right? So that's what you want to balance these. And so there's heuristics that say if the dual is getting too small too fast, then you either increase rho or decrease rho. I can't remember. It's one or the other, but you do one of those two things, right? And these things work okay. And then someone might ask, oh, does your theory work when rho is changing? The answer is no. And then you just say something like, fine, we'll stop changing rho after 50 steps. and then the theory works. And then, so there's that. So there's various ways to actually, a bunch of my students came up with a method that tunes rho based on 1910 rules for PID tuning from control theory. Because if you, it's exactly that. If rho is too high, you get like an overshoot like this. If it's too low or something, it's the other way around maybe, then you get this like thing like that. And if you get, and you want something that's like critical damping. So notice that I'm not really answering the question. Okay, just to make that completely explicit. So no one knows. No, it's actually not really. I mean, so you. No.
And say, oh, you should absolutely not disagree with the math, right? And then yeah. You say, oh, you can slightly disagree and we'll make progress together, right?
Yeah.
And then this is this trade-off, right? So this is progress.
No, it turns out for a lot of these things, there's actually a big region where it works just fine. And you have to, and you do have to have competent scaling. It is a first order method. Right? And in a first order method, scaling is critical. That's the whole point of a second order method, is scaling is second order, right? So yes, you have to scale things correctly. I guarantee you, if you make one equation, you know, the right hand, you know, the typical number is like 1e minus 6 and the next one 1e plus 3, it's game over. Of course it's not going to work. So if you take the, if you equilibrate the, you know, the matrices involved, it's actually usually not that big a deal. So put it this way, there's a lot of people looking at this, and I don't know, there's already been 5 papers on optimal rho selection. And the truth is, you really don't even want it rho. You want it to be a diagonal matrix, not a single scalar. And that's the correct thing, or even a full-on preconditioner. So you really want to choose the quadratic form. So there's a lot of things going on like that, but it's by no means settled. But these things do work if things are done responsibly.
Does it require the data, like X or whatever, or the data to be recently be normalized?
Yes, yeah. You know, it doesn't require it. The theory requires nothing. It just works. Yes, to get. Yeah, although we often do it without that, and it's okay. Like, just works. So if things are, you know, reasonably scaled, then it just works, right? So for the dynamic stuff, rho equals 1 works just fine. That's assuming, you know, your stuff is scaled so that things are in kilowatts. The typical numbers you're going to see are going to be between, you know, minus 30 and plus 30. You're just fine. It's just going to work. Rho equals 1 is fine. That doesn't mean that it would be great to figure out good ways to do this, but it certainly doesn't. It's certainly not a showstopper. That's for sure. All right. There's one more thing.
Non-convex.
And this is the last one. And this is super interesting. So you can do. Let's take you go ADMM. Well, you remember what it is because you know what it is now. You minimize like over f plus a quadratic and g of z. So you could do the following. People are doing this now. Jonathan Yedidi and many other people are doing this. What you do is you apply ADMM, exactly that algorithm, to a non-convex problem. For example, f could be convex and g could be the indicator function of a variable being Boolean. So g is just the indicator function of every entry being either 0 or 1, right? F is the convex relaxation of the problem, okay? And in fact, solving a mixed integer convex problem is minimizing f of x plus g of z in that case, right? Now you just run ADMM, okay? Now, how do you project onto that? It's called rounding, right? So, but you could do much more sophisticated combinatorial structures. You could do, you know, whatever. I mean, anything where you can compute the projection easily. Okay, so that's, now you know the algorithm. And now you might ask, what can you say about the algorithm? The answer is absolutely nothing. Examples show it doesn't even have to converge at all, let alone to the solution. I mean, that'd be ridiculous, right? Okay, now having said that, yeah, so what it means is you keep track of the best point you've found. Having said that, these appear to be extremely effective heuristics, extremely. So for things like, you know, Sudoku and things like that, those are two trivial problems anyway. So, but for things like 3-sat, you go and you look at the phase transition boundary, they work as well as any other heuristic. So where they're generically solvable, these things work. Where they're generically unsolvable, they don't. And then in that little band in the middle where 3-sat problems are really hard, right, in the transition band, of course they don't work, but then nothing does. So people are doing this, it's very interesting.
So you said who did that?
Jonathan Yedidi is one person doing this. Yeah, and they have a great name for it. You know what they call it? I should have said that. So they have, it's the best algorithm name. It's like, leave it to the physicists to come up with a good name. This is unbelievable. It's fantastic. It's divide and concur. Okay. I mean, come on, that's good. That alone is a huge contribution right there, right? Because that's what it is, right? We are calling them, like, you know, replication consensus algorithms. I mean, who would you rather hang out with? Anyway, so obviously, right? So that's good. You had a question? No, notice we're not converging, but the residuals are getting small. So yes.
So has this been applied to some other integer programming problems?
Other which problems?
Some integer programming.
My students and I have been playing with it, and other people have written some things about it, and it appears to be quite effective. You can't say anything about it, as far as I know, yet. Maybe never, but yeah.
For the people doing the idiot-like thing where they're putting in this, you know, purely non-convex thing into the G, what about the, has anyone tried to compare that to alternative of a softened convexified G and then seeing how those two bake off against each other?
Yes.
Okay.
So a lot is unknown. Like, nothing is known about these kinds of things. Yeah. But this is actually kind of doing that. Because what you're doing is you're solving a relaxation. Yeah. I mean, here's what would you normally do? You'd solve the relaxation. That's just F. And then you'd round. Right? That would be the, you know, that'd be, what's a simple way to solve an integer convex problem that actually is probably for most applications just fine? The answer is solve the integer LP relaxation and round. You know, maybe do a little local thing to adjust things or whatever if you like. Right? Fine. Right? We all agree on that? So that's exactly one step. So what this does, that's the first step, is exactly that. Then you know what it does? It looks at the difference between the continuous variable and the rounded variable. By the way, if that variable, in the relaxation, that variable having 0, 1, the difference is 0. Okay? And then what it does is it increments u, or y, for that. And then what it does is the next time you solve a relaxation, variable number 3, which had come out as 0.3 and was rounded to 0, now has a slight incentive to move one way, but you're still solving this big problem with everything coupled, and so, I mean, the intuition behind why this would work is pretty good, but.
So is there a link with this history and that kind of second order information? Like sliding a range of gradients, or it looks a bit like that, right? The
Y. Yeah. Well, if you look closely at optimization problems, optimization methods, if you look long enough at them, they all start looking the same anyway. So, but we were just talking about that, right? So yes, right? So.
At the risk of flogging, it's a wonderful talk. You know, these methods, I understand that the iterations are fast, so let's not focus on 1 over t.
No, they need not be, right?
Yeah. Yeah. But then there's that whole other range of problems, like you're basically solving a linear solver with an iterative method, and it's all about condition numbers, and then the convergence is just fantastically better, right?
Yeah.
What's the hybrid? How do you get these kinds of techniques to look more like second-order methods?
Yeah, that's a great question. A lot of it would be preconditioning, okay. Right? That's exactly it, or chunking it. I mean, if you chunk a problem up that way, that's you're almost doing a preconditioning. So you might do crazy stuff like this. Take the linear part. Do an incomplete Cholesky on it. Use that as a, which could even be block. So that you're going to do different blocks on different things. You could do just block incomplete Cholesky. And then that's a preconditioner. And the hope is things like this will just work really well. We want them to be kind of automatic, though. So we don't want you to have to figure out a preconditioner every time. Right? We want it to be automatic.
Right. There's sort of a quadratic part, but then there's the lasso condition.
Yeah.
That does soft thresholding. You know, I wonder if the two will play together, or if they just fight.
We don't know.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. We do know that when you use lasso the way you want to use it, so that it's relatively sparse or something, that what comes out, these things are very, very, they converge very quickly. Just, you know, because one thing just keeps truncating all but, you know, 50 of the variables to zero, and it doesn't take long for the other one to kind of converge. So.
Good.
Yeah. Thanks. Cool.